In this video, we illustrate the idea of the branch and bound algorithm in the context of integer optimization. Let's consider this example. We have to solve a problem that we call P, which minimizes a function with two variables, x1 and x2. We have two inequality constraints. The two variables must be non-negative and they must be integer. Actually, we can calculate an upper bound on the optimal value of this problem by selecting one feasible solution and calculating its value. In this case, 0, 0 happens to be feasible, so the upper bound can be set to 0. Note that if it is not possible to find easily a feasible solution, we can always put the upper bound to plus infinity in the beginning of the algorithm. This is a representation of the feasible set of this problem. It is the intersection of the polyhedron defined by the inequality constraints and the lattice of integer values. In this case, we have 11 feasible solutions. So actually, the branch and bound algorithm is not necessary to solve it, but let's use it to illustrate how it works. The first thing we do is to calculate a lower bound on the objective function. To do that, we solve the relaxation problem. The relaxation problem is obtained by ignoring the integrality conditions. We obtain a linear optimization problem, and in that case, we can solve it using the graphical method. We plot the polyhedron, we forget the lattice of integer numbers, and this is the level line which corresponds to the minimum value. Therefore, the optimal solution of the relaxation is here. Its value is 1.5 for x1 and 2.5 for x2. The optimal solution of the relaxation is, as we've seen, 1.5, 2.5, and we can calculate the lower bound as the value of the objective function at that point. In that case, it's minus 3.5. We cannot do much with this lower bound yet. So what we will do is to divide the feasible set into two subsets. I will build two problems, P1 and P2, based on this principle. And here I have a copy of the original problem P and another copy of the original problem P. In order to partition the subset, what I'm doing is that I'm looking at one of the values of x, which is rational, which is not integer. In this case, I will take x2. When we solve the relaxation, we find x2 equals 2.5. Well, of course, it cannot be a solution for the integer problem. In the original problem, x2 is either less or equal to 2 or greater or equal to 3. It cannot be in between. And this is actually the two types of constraints that we will impose. For problem P1, we will impose that x2 is less or equal to 2. And for problem P2, we will impose that x2 is greater or equal to 3. It is indeed a partition of the original feasible set because any feasible solution in the original problem has a value of x2 which is either greater or equal to 3 or less or equal to 2. From a graphical point of view, problem P1 is defined by taking this constraint here and imposing to x2 to be below this constraint, while problem P2 imposes to x2 to be above this constraint. When we look at the illustration here, we observe that actually P2 here is infeasible. There is actually no feasible solution of the original problem with a value of x2 which is greater or equal to 3. It is actually useful to gather all the information that we have been calculating so far into a tree representation. We have here a node that corresponds to the original problem, and we have calculated a lower bound on this problem. It's equal to minus 3.5. I use square brackets to show that it is a lower bound. Then I have divided the problem P into two problems, P1 and P2, and I have not calculated any lower bound yet. But I have detected that P2 is infeasible. Therefore, I just remove it from the tree. It's always good on the side of the tree to keep in memory the upper bound, but in this case, the upper bound is still 0 as it was in the beginning of the algorithm. Now what we have to do is to try to solve P1. And actually, if you look at that tree, you realize that if you solve P1, because P2 is infeasible, the solution of P1 will also be the solution of the original problem. This is the feasible set of problem P1 with this additional constraint that x2 must be less or equal to 2. If you look at the set of feasible solutions of this problem, we find the 11 solutions of the original problem. The feasible set is the same, but the polyhedron that characterizes the relaxation is different. We have cut one portion of it, and this is how the algorithm is making progress, actually. We need now to calculate a lower bound for problem P1. To do this, we need to solve the relaxation. Well, we do as before. We take the original problem, and we get rid of the integrality condition. This is a linear optimization problem. In that simple example, we can solve it with the graphical method, and we obtain this solution. It is the point which is 0.75. It is interesting to see that the value of x2 at the optimal solution of this subproblem is an integer. And this is not a coincidence. It happens to be an integer because we have added the constraint x2 less or equal to 2, and this constraint happens to be active at the solution of the problem, imposing this solution to be integer. The optimal solution of the relaxation is 0.752, and we can calculate the lower bound by calculating the value of the objective function for this solution. It's -3.25. Now we need to divide again. We need to generate two subproblems that I denote by P11 and PY2. To do that, I include two copies of problem P1, these two copies here, and I apply the same method as before. I select a value of x which is not an integer. In that case, there is only one, x1, which is 0.75. And I include as a constraint the fact that x1 must be either less or equal to 0 or greater or equal to 1. This partition can be represented on this illustration. Problem P11 contains these two feasible solutions, and problem P12 contains the 9 feasible solutions here. In this case, the two subproblems are feasible, and we see that they represent a partition of the problem P1. Let's look at the tree representation. So we have that the upper bound is still at 0. We have not changed it yet. We have calculated the lower bound on problem P, which is -3.5. We have divided problem P into P1 and P2. P2 happened to be infeasible, therefore we have removed it from the tree. We have then calculated a lower bound on P1. It's -3.25. And we have used the optimal solution of the relaxation to divide problem P1 into problem P11 and P12. Now we need to proceed again, and we will start by looking at this node here, problem P11. To calculate a lower bound, we will solve the relaxation problem. Again, this relaxation problem is obtained by ignoring the integrality constraint. And something that you want to realize is that if you take these two constraints together, it actually means that x1 must be equal to 0, because it must be non-negative and non-positive. Because x1 must be constrained to be equal to 0, the polyhedron of the relaxation problem happens to be this segment here. It has only two vertices, and the vertex which is optimal, it's this one. The solution is 0.15. Note that it's not an integer solution yet. We have the optimal solution of the relaxation. It's 0.15. The lower bound is obtained by calculating the value of the objective function at this optimal solution. It's -3. Now we can do the same for problem P12. Again, in order to solve the relaxation problem, we ignore the integrality constraints and solve the linear optimization problem. This is the polyhedron of this relaxation for problem P12, and the optimal solution is on this vertex, And this is 1, 2. This is interesting because this solution is an integer solution. It belongs to the polyhedron and it's integer. It means that it's a feasible solution for the original problem. It also means that it is an optimal solution for problem P12. It's the best out of all the feasible solutions of the relaxation. In particular, it's better than all integer solutions. And because it happens to be integer as well, this is the optimal solution. It means that by calculating the solution of the relaxation problem, we happen to find the optimal solution of the integer optimization problem, at least on the subset of feasible solutions for problem P12. So if we summarize, the optimal solution of the relaxation for P12 is 1, 2. The lower bound is -3. This is an integer solution. Therefore, it's optimal for P12. It's also a feasible solution for the original problem P. It means that we have found a better upper bound than before. The upper bound used to be 0. Now we have found a lower upper bound, which is -3. Let's summarize all this in a tree. We have updated the upper bound to -3. We had calculated a lower bound on problem P. Then we had separated P into P1 and P2. P2 was infeasible, so we were working on P1. We have calculated a lower bound on P1, and then we have separated P1 into P11 and P12. I have calculated a lower bound on P11. It's -3. And I've been able to solve P12 to optimality. I represent it using a circle for this node, meaning that I have solved it. And I put regular brackets here to show that this is actually the optimal solution of P12. Now we can start exploiting the bounds in order to solve the problem. Problem P11 has a lower bound, which is -3. Whatever the optimal solution is of this problem, the value of the objective function will be -3 or larger. It cannot be below because -3 is a lower bound. Therefore, there is no feasible solution of P11 that will be better than P12. It means that we don't need to consider this problem anymore. It will not provide us with a better solution than the one we have found in P12. Now let's look at P1. P1 was partitioned into P11 and P12. And we know that the best solution of this partition will be provided by partition 1, 2 here. And because we have solved all the subsets in the partition, well, there were only two here, we have actually solved P1. The solution of P1 is also -3. And now we are done because as we have seen, P1 is exactly the same problem as P. It has the same set of feasible solution and the same objective function. So we have found a solution for the original problem. This problem is very simple and it does not illustrate the full power of this branch and bound technique, but it shows that we could solve the original problem without a need to solve all the subproblems that were generated. Problem P11 didn't need to be solved to optimality in order to find the exact solution of the original problem. And when the problems become larger, there are more and more problems that can be eliminated using this technique, avoiding the need to enumerate a lot of solutions that we know will be inferior anyway. The branch and bound method for integer optimization applies the divide and conquer strategy progressively. It has three main components. The branching, you identify a fractional variable and branch on it, as we have seen. It calculates lower bounds using the relaxation. And it maintains the best upper bound, which is the best feasible solution found so far. It's actually a good idea to maintain the progress of the algorithm in a tree, as we have illustrated.